out, we have a very dynamic team, and this is an effort, team effort. So friends, enjoy today's academic feast. Now, I would like to invite Dr. Ambuja to carry out further proceedings. Dr. Ambuja, please.
Dr. Ambuja, is there? No, she's not there, but I think you can invite the chairpersons, and we have two chairpersons today. Yes. One is Dr. Meeta Singh, and Dr. Vanita.
I would like to invite Dr. Vanita Suri and Dr. Meeta Singh for I think Dr. Meeta, there is nobody in the IMS that does not know Dr. Meeta, a hardcore academician and a good guide for IMS. She has written IMS guidelines, and we are very much thankful to her for that. Dr. Meeta, please.
Thank you, Dr. Kanchan, for your kind words.
Yes.
Good evening, dear friends. I think we start the program. Now, aging and menopause are interrelated, and both lead to depletion of energy and bone mass. Calcium and vitamin D are two important pillars for bone health. We all know this. And today we are going to learn about these two essential ingredients for good menopausal health. These lectures will be delivered by two great ladies who have many things in common. I know both of them. First, both are passionate about menopause and menopausal health issues. They have done a lot of good work in this area. Second, both have and are holding important positions in Menopausal Society, Chandigarh chapter, as well as the national group. As we know, Dr. Neeja was the pioneer president, Chandigarh chapter, and Dr. Neeja as ex-IMS president. Third, now both are role models for menopausal ladies. They believe in practicing before preaching. Both are in good shape and very fit. And last but not the least, both are my very dear friends. So first of all, I'll invite Dr. Neelam Agarwal, who shall be talking on clinical aspects of calcium. Neelam, please.
Thank you, Dr. Vinita, for the kind words. Is my screen visible? Is my screen visible?
Yes, yes.
Okay, so Neeja specifically told me to talk about clinical aspects of calcium. So I will be mostly restricting myself to calcium only, and I'm not going in details about osteoporosis. So today is mostly calcium, and I'll be focusing on why calcium and calcium. Everybody talks about calcium. And because calcium is an important mineral and is responsible for bone health, so we will be talking about peak bone mass and clinical aspects of calcium, which calcium, what to give, when to give, how much to give, and whether too much also is not good. And finally, maybe some carry home messages everybody can gather from my talk. Regarding calcium, some of the facts remain that calcium is important for bone function, muscles, both smooth and skeletal muscles functioning. And also it helps in clotting of blood. And calcium metabolism is controlled by parathyroid hormone, vitamin D, and calcitonin. 99% of calcium is present in skeletal, and 99% is in bones and teeth. Bones are the main repository of calcium. And calcium provides mechanical strength. Bones provide mechanical strength to the body, as well as they act as a buffer to control the calcium homeostasis. When calcium level is low or high, there is withdrawal of calcium or deposition of calcium in or from the bones. Right? And bone strength is determined mainly by bone mass. How much peak bone mass means maximum bone mass somebody has, from that bone strength, and also and determinants of peak bone mass, apart from genetic factors, the modifiable factors are nutritional status, physical activity and gonadal status. Genetic factors are the immodifiable factors for the determination of the peak bone mass as to how much bone mass somebody can assimilate. Because peak bone mass is assimilated by mostly by 30 years of age. So how much it can be done? Like we keep on assimilating money till the end. But it is unlike that. Bone bank maximum can be filled till 30 years. So bones as this skeleton may look dead, but bones are actually living organs. And till last day, bones are constantly working. And so this repository for calcium is in a continuous turnover and is changing its value every day. So this is the cycle for the bone resorption and bone formation. This first figure is the resting state of the bone, and then there starts the resorption of the bone and like then reformation of the bone, of that resorbed bone. So there has to be reformation of the bone, and this is called bone remodeling. So for this, calcium is important, and bone mass is maintained because of continuous activity, bone forming cells or osteoblasts, and the bone destroying cells, osteoclasts. Bone gain and bone mass, loss of bone continues throughout the lifespan of an individual, and bone balance at a particular time of life is the balance between gain and loss of bone. So like this green line is the bone peak bone mass, formation of the peak bone mass, and about 25 to 30 years is the peak bone mass, and which remains like that till menopause. In females, after menopause, there is a sudden decline of peak bone mineral density, BMD. Suddenly bone starts losing because of the estrogen withdrawal, because estrogen is required for calcium absorption as well as for the after estrogen is gone, osteoclastic activity. So this yellow line shows resorption of bone, and purple is the bone formation. So bone formation and resorption till 30 years of age is almost till about 10-12 years is almost the same, and then it suddenly increases. Bone formation is much more than the bone resorption, and bone resorption in females especially is suddenly after the menopause, and then after that age-related resorption continues. So this is the male in the males and females. In males, after a certain age, there is a continuous age-related decline. But here, because of menopause, there is a sudden decline of bone mass after the menopause. That is why women are more prone to have osteo-related fractures. 1 in 2 women, whereas 1 in 4 men, as compared to 1 in 4 men, are prone to osteoporosis-related fractures. Bone is made up of bone matrix, where there are collagen fibers and minerals, which are the calcium salts. And addition of mineral to the matrix is bone mineralization, which is very, very essential for hardness and rigidity of bone. So the two important minerals for the hardness and rigidity of bone are calcium and phosphorus. If mineralization is less, bones are weak and fragile, leading to osteoporosis. That is why calcium is so important. And osteoporosis, although we think that osteoporosis is a disease of the aged people, but whereas as early as 1972, Charles Edent had remarked that senile osteoporosis in fact is a pediatric disease, not a geriatric disease. So this is very important to learn about the calcium clinically. So think of bones as our saving account. And bone bank, you can, as I already told you, maximum filling of the bone bank is till 30 years of age. And by about 20 to 30 years of age, 98% of the bone mass is formed. And then as a process of aging process, bones start getting depleted. So bones should be built up till 30 years of age so as to have a better defense against developing osteoporosis later on, and for filling this piggy bank of bones, calcium and vitamin D, these are the two important things. I will speak about calcium and Dr. Neeja about vitamin D. So these are the most important things for peak bone mass. These are the dietary sources of calcium. Everybody knows about the dairy sources of calcium, milk, cheese, yogurt, etc. And then green leafy vegetables, dry fruits, nuts and seeds, lean meats, poultry, fish and eggs. They are another important sources of dietary calcium. And according to this is Institute of Medicine, all the daily requirements, starting from very means first day of birth, from birth onwards, everybody requires certain amount of calcium. And this is the 51 to 70 years, 1200 milligrams. Even our Indian Menopause Society requirement is also the same. These are some dietary products where calcium quantity is given. So amongst the vegetables, broccoli, okra, beans, spinach, methi, mustard seeds, all these have good amount of calcium. Especially broccoli is a good amount of good source of calcium. So whether to take dairy dietary calcium or supplements, as I told you, showed you that nearly 1 gram of calcium is required from adulthood, means roughly on an average 1000 milligrams if we take from the adulthood till the menopausal age. So you cannot get this much calcium from diet alone, however good the diet may be, because 1 cup of milk is around 200 milligrams of calcium and 1 cup of curd is 300 milligrams of calcium. So, but advantages of dietary calcium are that the absorption is more physiological and there is no risk of renal calculi because oxalate is bound by the dietary calcium. But disadvantage is that various food contents have a variable content of calcium and bioavailability is also different. And this dietary calcium is alone inadequate to meet the recommended intake. And so to fulfill the shortfall from the dietary calcium, calcium supplements need to be prescribed. So disadvantages being that bioavailability of different contents are different. And if you take large bolus, means you take total of 1 gram or 1.5 grams or 2 grams calcium at one time, this is an unphysiological dose and does not get absorbed. Then is the cost, GI side effects. Then I will also be taking up controversies of renal calculi and cardiovascular risks with calcium intake. So various salts of calcium which are available are, main is the calcium carbonate and other one is the calcium citrate. Calcium carbonate has more elemental calcium and so lesser tablets are needed and it's a cheaper tablet. But main disadvantage is that it needs gastric acid for absorption and so has to be taken postprandially and it gives more GI side effects like bloating, flatness. Calcium citrate is more soluble, better absorbed and not dependent on gastric acid. So can be taken irrespective of food and intake. And so is thought to be safe in patients, persons who have renal calculi. But disadvantage is the elemental calcium content is less in calcium citrate. So more number of tablets are needed and also it is costlier than calcium carbonate. So these are, this is the graphic representation of different calciums. Here without food, with food, calcium carbonate, calcium citrate, they are almost similarly bioavailable shown by one study, but that this is a very, very old study. Calcium citrate malate is a calcium salt of citric acid and malic acid. It is better soluble than even calcium citrate. Elemental calcium is 26% and bioavailability is 35 to 42% and may improve with orange juice also. This form, calcium citrate malate, is used for calcium fortification of juices. and is well absorbed even if you are taking it without food. So no relation with the food intake. Then is calcium orotate. Two molecules of orotic acid combine to form a single molecule of calcium orotate, in which a calcium atom takes the place of two hydrogen atoms and is found in almost all living organisms in small quantities. So supposed to have good intracellular entry, but there is not much clinical data. There it is not, has not been used much clinically because there is hardly any elemental calcium in this salt if it is to be taken as a clinical supplement. Then coral calcium is calcium carbonate derived from coral, and initially, especially studies from Japan had good claims from coral calcium, but however, its benefits as anti-aging agent and anti-cancer benefits from coral calcium, they have been unfounded. Clinical studies have not shown any much of benefit with this coral calcium. Then bone meal calcium, calcium from the bones, has been stopped. This preparation, these preparations from bones have been stopped because there has been found to be heavy metal contamination like lead, arsenic, mercury, cadmium, etc. And microcrystalline hydroxypeptide derived from bovine bone. Inorganic component contains calcium and phosphorus, organic component collagen and bone specific growth peptides. So they also claim about its better efficacy, but has not been proven in large trials, and heavy metal contamination definitely is there, so is not recommended. So how much calcium to be given? So in general, on an average, they say from 1000 milligram, if 1000 milligram is the requirement, half should be from the diet and half should be from the supplements. And maximum single dose, not more than 500 milligram of elemental calcium should be given at one time. Maximum 500 milligram elemental calcium at one time. Even smaller, more frequent doses, that is 200 milligram of elemental iron 6 hourly, is supposed to be associated with better biological effects by suppressing parathyroid hormone. But compliance for 4 times taking a calcium tablet with lesser of elemental calcium is an issue. So usually it is given like 500 milligram calcium in a single dose and maximum of 2 tablets in a day. Calcium carbonate should be prescribed with food because to ensure the presence of acid, and citrate can be given irrespective of the timing of food. So whether calcium to be given at daytime or nighttime, there is no consistent difference in the efficacy shown. And previously, as thought to be nighttime calcium not to be given because of its bad effects on the cardiovascular, ischemic cardiovascular disease, that is also now no more proven. So can be given either in the day or in the night, and maximum 500 milligram elemental iron, calcium in one tablet. So what should be added to calcium? That if you see different calcium preparations, there are so many things added to the calcium like magnesium, isoflavones, vitamin K, but theoretical benefits of all of these have not been shown, not been updated by the studies. So they have not been tested and not proven by the clinical studies. Addition of trace elements and minerals in suboptimal quantities is widely practiced but is a useless practice. So this vitamin D, Nirja will be talking about vitamin D. These are the drug interactions with calcium. Mainly is the H2 blockers and proton pump inhibitors, which lead to the decreased absorption of calcium. Then bisphosphonates, renal clearance is reduced by bisphosphonates. Thiazides also reduce the absorption. And calcium interferes with some of the drugs like some antibiotics, for example, tetracyclines, quinolones, thyroxine, iron supplements, and where there are drugs which have been prescribed for gastric acid secretion inhibition, like in acidity and GRDS, etc., there calcium citrate should be preferred. And even in the older age, calcium citrate should be preferred because there is less of gastric acid production in the with age is reduced. Prolonged use of proton pump inhibitors can also cause blood bone loss because they affect the calcium absorption. So other items which interact with calcium absorption in the food is phytic acid, for example, in wheat, that also decreases calcium absorption. Iron, zinc, magnesium also interfere. Too much of salt and calcium, caffeine, they increase hypercalciuria and less of bioavailable calcium. So there are two issues with the calcium supplements. One is renal stones, whether calcium leads to renal stones. As much as 2.5 grams per day, up to 2.5 grams per day, calcium is supposed to be safe and not does not give rise to renal stones. And there have been few studies which have shown increased cardiovascular risk with calcium, but not definitely proven. In fact, if a diet is too low in calcium, that dietary calcium inadequacy may increase the risk of calculi because calcium prevents less of oxalate absorption, because dietary calcium absorbs the oxalate and so there are no oxalate stones. And also query secondary hyperparathyroidism, parathyroid state occurs because of low calcium. Calcium plus vitamin D reported for increased risk of calculi in WHI study is probably due to methodological flaw and not otherwise. So safe limit of 2,500 milligram calcium should not be exceeded to prevent renal stones. The calcium citrate or citrate malleate is preferred for better absorption. So how do you know how much calcium you are getting? Suppose there is a dietary label. Now this is the dietary label, where calcium is 6%, right? How will you know how much is the calcium? So what does it mean? Nutrition labels, 30% calcium, 20% calcium, 100% calcium, how many milligrams? So daily intake is supposed to be baseline, against a baseline daily intake of 1000 milligrams, this percentage is calculated. For example, 30% calcium is 300 milligrams, 20% calcium 200 milligrams, like that. So this is the summary position statement of various societies on calcium intake. So in this, calcium and vitamin, means from calcium point of view, calcium and vitamin D lead to modest reduction in fracture. This called the population level interventions have not been shown to be effective public health strategy. And supplementation with calcium alone for fracture reduction is not supported by the literature. Side effects mainly are gastrointestinal symptoms. And vitamin D supplementation rather than calcium supplementation reduces risk of falls because of the muscle stability. Assertion of increased cardiovascular risk consequent to calcium supplementation are not convincingly supported by the current evidence. So calcium is an integral component of bone health. Starts from calcium requirement, calcium bone formation starts from in utero and continues till the age of 30. Peak bone mass is achieved by 30 years of age. Bone bank and bone balance, positive bone balance is more important than the nutrient bank. And there is not much difference in calcium preparations. Citrate preparation should be preferred in old age as carbonate needs acid for absorption. Thank you.
Thank you, Neelam, for a very brilliant talk. And you have reviewed nicely the role of calcium and the different calcium preparations. Should we ask now questions? Let them, Nija, because if Neelam has to leave, or maybe end of the talk?
End of the
talk. End of the talk. Okay. So now, Dr. Meeta, please invite Dr. Nija.
Neelam, your screen sharing?
I stopped sharing, Nija. Thank you.
Is Meeta there?
I can see Meeta, I think.
He hasn't unmuted her, this thing. Yeah, now.
A very good evening, everybody. Thank you so much for inviting me to this very interesting, very basic, but very important nevertheless, because and I think Neelam has really gone through it very, very nicely. Especially she went through it very fully, concentrating on things which are really important in your clinical practice. So she has actually listened to Neeraja saying that it has to be a very clinical oriented talk, and I think fantastic job there. Neeraja is a very dear friend, and I especially have very fond memories because I was installed as the secretary of the Indian Menopause Society at the PGI meet, you know, the Indian Menopause Society meet that happened at Chandigarh, and Neeraja was heading at that time, and it was a very wonderful meet, and we really enjoyed that entire session. And I remember she had brought out some very unique aspects of menopausal health during that time. And one such topic that she had was travel at menopause. And I don't think they ever touched that topic again after that, Neeraja. So over to you, clinical aspects of vitamin D, and I'm looking forward to listen to it.
So thank you, Meeta, and thank you, Vanita. And I do need to inform all the participants that a lot of my quotations are from Meeta's clinical practice guidelines on osteoporosis for postmenopausal women. It is an excellent book in that book. And Vanita, of course, is a brilliant academician. So good afternoon to both of you. Vanita also heads the Department of Obs and Gynae at PGI. And so I need to talk about the clinical aspects of vitamin D after a brilliant talk by Neelam. And what we need to actually see is that it is so unfortunate that in sun-drenched India, the way they say, we have a national nutritional deficiency pandemic of vitamin D. 35% of the population is actually deficient. Our country is actually unique in one way that we have a twin nutrient deficiency of calcium and vitamin D. And most of the reasons for vitamin D deficiency are because of modernization. The new normal is so agriculture, they become mechanized and we are more inbound, which is one of the reasons why we have this deficiency. Now, briefly, I wanted to look at the photobiology of vitamin D. This is very essential to know where we are. What are the terms that we are using? And for referral, as I go on in my talk. So very briefly, that we are looking at how we are sourcing vitamin D from the sun. So we have 7-D hydrocholesterol, which is a pro-vitamin D3, which is in the lipid layer of our skin. Under the effects of sun, you 15 nanometers wavelength. So this is converted into the pre-vitamin in the same lipid layer of the epidermis. And this undergoes conformational change at body temperature to form the cholecalciferol, which is all what we are familiar with, and we generally call it vitamin D3. This is through the plasma membranes into the extracellular space. And when it reaches the liver, it is undergoes another change and becomes 25-hydroxy vitamin D3. Now, we must understand that this one is circulating level of vitamin D3, which is what we measure. We are not measuring this or this. We're actually measuring this when we are testing vitamin D in the blood. So this undergoes 125 dihydroxy D3 in the kidneys and other tissues and forms calcitriol. Calcitriol is the active form of vitamin D. All the actions are because of calcitriol. Now, in we are acquiring this pro vitamin D3 when we are taking supplements from outside, from wool grease, which is given UV light and then undergoes purification. Vitamin D2 is called ergocalciferol, and it is derived from yeast and mushrooms, which are exposed to sunlight and UV light. So how does vitamin D act? The calcitriol, which is the active form of vitamin D, it increases the intestine absorption of calcium as well as phosphorus. The parathyroid hormone, it converts 25-hydroxy-D3, the cholecalciferol, into the active form of vitamin D. And there is an endocrine axis of calcium, vitamin D, and the parathyroid hormone. Secreted benefits. So when this increases, this is called secondary hyperparathyroidism. What does this increase secondarily to a low calcium level when the parathyroid hormone increases? What does it do? It tries to maintain the calcium homeostasis. So it will reabsorb calcium from the bone, it will reabsorb calcium from the kidneys. Can you mute yourself, Kanchan? So the effect of this is that the bone resorption happens because it is taking out calcium from the bone and the bone mineral density becomes lower. So vitamin D is inversely related to the parathyroid hormone. When it increases, the parathyroid hormone will actually increase, and vitamin D is responsible for the bone mineral density. So what are the actions of vitamin D? It has skeletal actions. It increases the bone mineral density, the bones, as well as enhances the response of the bones to the medicines which we are giving to increase the bone mass. It also has a lot of skeletal benefits, benefits other than the bone. Muscle strength, cancer risks, immunity, inflammation, cardioprotective, autoimmune, pregnancy, as well as the neonate. So we have a lot of extra skeletal benefits and actions of vitamin D. So how would you estimate if you want to find out what your vitamin D is? What will you do? So you will evaluate the serum 25-hydroxy vitamin D3, which is a proxy for the vitamin D status of the body. And this is the best way of estimating vitamin D status. We do have alternate assays, 125-dihydroxy-D3 parathyroid hormone, markers of bone turnover, but they complement this, but they are not routinely advised. Estimation of serum calcium may be important in severe vitamin deficiency or in toxicity. And calcitriol assessment is not used except in acquired or inherited disorders of vitamin D and phosphate metabolism. So you see what happens is that 24-hydroxylase, when it gets deficient, large amount of this is produced, but less of the 25-hydroxy-D3. So when should you test for the vitamin D status? So whenever you are thinking that there is any bone osteoporosis or any musculoskeletal disease which may improve on vitamin D treatment, or any bone diseases where you are going to give some treatment, and if you correct the vitamin D, then your results are enhanced. So these two conditions you will like to estimate the vitamin D status. But a routine testing in a patient who already has an osteoporotic fracture before you start the treatment is not really required. So we all know that we need a particular amount of serum values of vitamin D for it to work best for the bone mineral density and for the prevention of fractures. We know that more than 30 nanograms per ml is of little benefit. Now, when we talk of how much vitamin D, so that sufficiency value, what is the sufficient value for white bones to be perfect? That value changes in different societies. So you have the sufficiency value more than 30 for the American Association of Clinical Endocrinologists as well as the American College of Endocrinologists. So this is according to their guidelines. But when you have Institute of Medicine, then you have a different sufficiency level. So what I do want to say is that generally this is what we follow. And we say that more than 30 nanogram per ml is sufficient. Sometimes your lab will give you reports in nanomoles per liter. So these are equivalent. So then there will be what we call as a deficiency below 20 and insufficiency between 20 to 32. So the upper limit, what is a normal upper limit? That is a little controversial also. Generally, we will say 30 to 60 nanograms per ml is perfectly fine because it will increase in those areas which are very sunny. But more than 100 is considered as excess and not safe. And more than 50 leads to toxicity. If you wish to convert from nanograms per ml to moles per liter, you just need to multiply the nanograms per ml by 2.5. So at one time, we used to think that vitamins do not cause toxicity, but yes, they do, especially not just oil soluble, but even the water soluble B complex high doses can cause toxicity. So same is true here. It does cause toxicity when it is more than, say, 150 nanogram per ml. And why does this happen is mostly because of overdose and in certain granulomatous diseases and mutation of the 24-hydroxylase gene. As I mentioned that if the mutation of this, then what happens is that calcitriol becomes too much, but the cholecalciferol becomes less, or the estimated values of this is less. This is known as calcifemidol. So when this becomes less, we think that the vitamin D levels are less and physiological levels even cause hypersensitivity and cause toxicity. The symptoms of this range from general malaise and even death. In fact, I want to share with you that my mother by mistake took injectable vitamin D, thinking she's taking a B complex injection, and she had to be in ICU and she was nearing death when we diagnosed the problem and got her out of it. So what is the recommended daily allowances? See, one thing also we are very sure about this fact that a daily 400 international is insufficient. So you do need much more. The RDA for the US Endocrine Society are different, and for ICMR, they are different. But generally, what we are following in most guidelines is the US Endocrine Society guidelines. Just 1 minute, please. Sorry, my dog has a little problem, so I had to attend to him. So we have these US guidelines, which are very good and which is generally what we are following. But listen, the nighttime workers will need this the whole year round. And those adults who are at risk will need 2 to 3 times more than what is normal for their age group. But upper limit, as I put here, should not be more than 10,000 per day. So how can we source? So here we are going to look at how we can source the sun for our vitamin D. So it is the most physiological way. If you are in around the equator being 0-0, if you are 40 degrees north and south of the equator, very close to it, one of the most physiological ways of acquiring your vitamin D is getting an endogenous production of vitamin D in your own skin. But of course, many environmental factors and personal factors like the dress code, the religion, pigmentation, all of these will impact. India comes under that within 40 degrees north of equator. But then winter seasons will have weak sun, night, there'll be no sun. The time of the day is very important. So you can understand this word solar zenith angle. This is the vertical angle made to the vertical. Now the solar zenith angle is usually oblique in winters, in early mornings and late afternoons, because the UVB photons do not reach. So if you want to take the best benefit of sun, you must do it between 10 a.m. to 3 p.m. And here we have the minimal erythemal dose. The minimal erythemal dose, if it is 1, this is referred to as those people who are 100% body exposed and they are in a swimsuit and the whole body develops a slight pinkishness. It is said that in that state, they are actually producing 20,000 international units of vitamin D per day. So you can't do that, but you can expose your upper body. And for 30 to 45 minutes, this will be about 15% of your body with no sunscreen. And what is suggested is that during the lunch hour is the best time to take your sunshine walk, where you will get around 400 international units of vitamin endogenously produced daily. So other than that, we have food. But you can, as you can see in this list, it's such a limited amount of foodstuffs. So government of India has actually allowed a fortification of foods to increase the RDA. So 30 to 40% of the RDA can be fortified in foods. And in India, we have milk of all kinds, the toned, the double toned, the full fat, all the milks, they can be, and some are, fortified with vitamin D and oils. Now, this is the amount that they can fortify in a liter, which means that you need to take 700 ml per day of milk or milk products and 30 ml per day of oil. Now, this is not possible. This kind of fortification is not accessible to many people in our country. So you see, fortification is not available. Dietary sources are limited and slight exposure has its own limitations. So what has become important is to supplement your requirement with supplements. Now just have a look at this. This is very briefly to tell you that the D3 and the D2, they are the ones which are actually used in supplements. The calcitriol is the active form in the body, and alpha calcidol is the synthetic analog of calcitriol. This is less potent, but all these analogs that you are seeing on your screen, they are not used to manage vitamin D deficiency, including calcitriol, because some products in the market do contain calcitriol. But remember, they are used to be used in those conditions which are not under the purview of the gynecologist. So you would never need to use any of these. So now the question is, which D? Should you use D3 or D2? Now, of course, this has a little advantage that this is vegetarian, but D3 is what is the preferred choice because of its potency. It is much more potent than D2. Efficacy, its safety, and availability. If you're looking on the net for availability of D2, you will have a tough time. So these are available in various forms, capsules, granules, etc., various strengths. The question is, what route to give it? Should you take it oral or should you take it as injections? Injections, of course, they are cost effective. Compliance is much more. So can you visualize the elderly couple who takes injectable? They are more happier rather than add another pill to their whatever the large number of pills that they take. The disadvantage of injections is that the toxicity is more likely. And that horrifying example of my own mom is good to actually put me off because of the toxicity of injections. So we have come to this point that if you have to take a supplement, D3 is preferred and oral is preferred, whether you're treating a vitamin D deficiency or you're maintaining the vitamin D levels in your blood. So what dose? Now, if you need a very rapid correction, like patient has symptomatic disease and before using any potent injectable anti-resorptive therapy, then this is the regimen that you should follow. you should give a fixed load. The fixed load is high dose. It's an intermittent high dose. So you need to give 3 lakh international units over 6 to 10 weeks. This converts to actually more than 7, but approximately 6,000 IU per day. I'll put a question mark on that because this is given in the recommendation. So I've put it here, but I have my own doubts whether we can do that because many places mention that do not give more than 4,000 IU per day. So when you have to give a fixed load, it might be wiser to give intermittently, not daily, but give it IU weekly, 50K or 60K. Or you can give intramuscular 6 lakhs IU for 1 year or 3 lakhs for 6 months. Remember that 6 lakhs is whenever you give is not repeated. Here it says if you require not before 3 months. But there are conditions like rickets, for example, which is again not the purview of the gynecologist, where they may give 6 lakhs every month. But this is not for us. So those are other specialists who may be giving. But for us, we give 6 lakhs for 1 year, 3 lakhs for 6 months. This has to be followed by maintenance dose. But when you're doing maintenance dosing, in this you can give daily or intermittent. So you can give orally 800 to 2000 IU daily, or you can give monthly in summer or twice in a month in winter, or if you have earlier given 6 lakhs repeated at 1 year and 3 lakhs repeated at 6 months. So your maintenance, you have maintained whatever you got advantage by loading it. But suppose the correction of vitamin D deficiency is not so urgent and you're just simply you're simply co-prescribing with other oral anti-resorptive therapy, then you don't need to give a loading dose. You can simply give maintenance dose and be done with it. Loading dose should never be more than 6 lakhs. Remember that whenever you load so much, there will be a paradoxical increased rate of falls and fractures. So I'm repeating here that the loading dose is only required in symptomatic disease and before potent injectable anti-resorptive therapy. Otherwise, just maintenance dose is good enough. A little bit about this. Loading dose, whether it's oral or parenteral, is not given in pregnancy unless the patient has symptoms plus plus. There is a tetany or very severe hypocalcemia. If the patient circulating value of 20 to 30, what we say is insufficient, not deficient, and she's on appropriate supplements, then check yourself whether the supplements are appropriate, she's taking correctly. If despite that, she doesn't have improvement of her values, then increase the dose by 50%, reassess at 6 months. But if her vitamin D serum values are normal and she's on supplements, then continue maintenance therapy with calcium. The idea is to keep the circulating value of D more than 30 nanograms per ml. So how long? So they say that the osteoid seams, which are the unmineralized organic matrix, they take 15 years to mineralize. So it's possible you might have to give it that long. You have to give it as long as you can continue to maintain it. So how will you monitor it? How will you monitor whatever therapy you're giving? So routine monitoring of the vitamin D status is not required. What we need to do is monitor the calcium, the corrected value of calcium for the albumin. So the formula is on your screen. So check your calcium 1 month after completion of the loading dose or 1 month after starting of the vitamin D supplementation, just to see that primary hyperparathyroid has not been unmasked. If the calcium is more than 10.5, then this points towards vitamin D toxicity. But if the fasting urine calcium to creatinine ratio, the creatinine in milligram percent, is more than 0.25, then this could be vitamin D excess. all vitamin D supplements should take calcium for desired skeletal benefits, because as I said earlier, and I highlight, we are a twin nutrient deficiency state of calcium and vitamin D. As I come to, so there was a trial in UK which said that as long as the vitamin D you're taking is around 800 IU a day, it is vitamin D is important. Calcium is not critical. So you need to just take this much irrespective of the calcium. Icelandic researchers, in fact, found similar things. And they said that if your vitamin D is normal, then more than 800 milligrams of calcium is not required. If vitamin D is sufficient, then this itself will ensure an ideal PTH value, even if calcium is low. But if vitamin D is insufficient, then however much of calcium you give, you will not be able to maintain ideal PTH values. So my last slide is to say that vitamin D status, all these recommendations that we have talked about, they refer, of course, vitamin D is important for all this, but the recommendations relate only to the optimization of vitamin D status for patients of musculoskeletal health. Now, if giving treatment to such patients improves their status, we cannot extrapolate and actually say that even though these problems do have vitamin D deficiency, that treating these things with similar vitamin D profiles and with supplementation will help. So that's all for today. Thank you all for a patient hearing.
Thank you.
Questions?
Are there any?
Meeta? Yes, Meeta has something to say. Unmute yourself.
I was able to do it myself. Thank you for that, Neeraj. Thank you for that brilliant talk. And I think you did a fantastic job in that short time, you know, bringing out the very important aspects of vitamin D detoxification also, you know, which has become so common, where the injectables are given once weekly, you know, without understanding that oral preparations, the doses are very different from the injectables. So I think that was a very important. And since you've spoken about your mother, people will remember it even more, you know, when there is a personal angle attached to it. Yeah, my question to you was, are you aware that the, you know, the ICMR and the NIN have actually initially our calcium requirement, of course, this is not vitamin D related, but since the second slide of yours, the last second slide of yours was very interesting in the sense that it's, if you're, it's not necessary to increase your calcium RDA. If you've got enough of your vitamin D, that is actually, you know, then it goes together to maintain the levels of both the calcium and the vitamin D for skeletal muscular health. But the NIN has ICMR 2020, they increased the requirement of calcium from 800 milligrams in postmenopausal women, which was earlier till 2019, to 1200. You know, this is a huge jump. And in an adult woman, it was 600 milligrams. Again, they have a huge jump to 1000 milligrams. So it's, and then they based it on the DEXA. This was not on like how the previous studies were done on the calcium clearance and vitamin D, you know, how they believe it is. So it's a DEXA based, which may be a little flimsy ground. So what do you think about that?
About the calcium, well, if they have said, the ICMR and the NIN have said so, then probably it must be true, because the recommendations and all, there is no standard thing. Even when we are sitting in India, we have Indian Academy of Pediatrics, we have ICMR, we have so many people coming to the really big problem. So, yeah. What exactly we need to do, how much to give, I think if we can just maintain our vitamin D levels in the blood and our bone mass, that should be good.
So because, you know, the amount an average Indian takes, if you look at the rural area, it's hardly 200 to 300.
Yes, exactly.
Yeah. Jumping to that high level, I mean, it was just a thought, which was when I saw that, I mean, I was wondering. And we should not end up using, you know, too much of supplements to reach that. You know, the doctors then will start thinking that we need to increase the dose, increase the amount of calcium that we need to give. So that's really a little fear when I read that article.
On the other hand, Meeta, you know my opinion on this. I have always maintained, even with the International Osteoporosis Foundation president, we had this talk with him. And I always maintain that stop calcium from dietary sources.
Like your vitamin D.
Source, which is good source. See, broccoli, one cup will give you 85 milligrams of calcium.
No. Let me interrupt you here. Neeraj, just look up the guidelines, which you are kind enough to mention. You look at the NIN, the recent one. They have done a fantastic job. And in that, if you really go to see ragi, 100 grams has got so much, more than 300. They take porridge every day in the morning. It fills you up very well. You just add a little bit of nuts in the ragi. You know, poor man's meal with some amount of groundnut and right, 300 milligrams. No, it is in Andhra, a lot of people have this ragi porridge either in lassi or with a little bit of gur. You know, gur has your minerals. So jaggery has the minerals. So actually, it becomes a complete meal for a poor person in Andhra.
That is for the point. That's an excellent take-home point. Very good. I'll also do that because I've always felt that I'm a little averse to milk, not because of sensitivity, but because of the cruelty to animals. So if the only source of dietary calcium is milk and milk products, I would rather take my supplement and leave the poor animal.
No, Neeraja. So I think what you should do is just look up the detailed chart of the calcium content in the Indian food, and you find in most of the lentils, our rajma, chole, tanada, one katori. So little detailing of that, because that really helps when you're giving these kind of, you know, information to your patients and your colleagues. And coming from Neeraja will make a difference.
Yeah, I'll definitely look it up, and I'm sure I will use it myself also. And we have a message from Alka Kumar who says ragi is a very good source of calcium. So yeah, so we all will actually go in for that, because I do have reservation about taking my calcium from the other animal.
I agree. Like, you know, you don't necessarily, because there are people, there is so much of lactose intolerance apart from, you know, the feeling that you have. There is a lot of lactose intolerance, so we need to have alternatives. And, you know, I mean, how do people survive all these years? I don't think the requirement is 1,000, 1,200. Maybe, like you said, if you have the right amount of vitamin D, even 600 to 800 mg is enough for your healthy health.
Yes. Vitamin D is considered to be more important and more protective of the parathyroid hormone. But the real trigger is
vitamin D, because you need the vitamin D. It's a vehicle to absorb that calcium out of your system. So kitna bhi calcium low, so if you don't have the vitamin D, the vehicle to absorb from the intestine, then it's not going to work.
Yes, absolutely right on dot.
Thank you so much for inviting me, and I really enjoyed both your talks. And, you know, it's always very nice to go back into a little bit of the basic detailing for understanding.
Yes.
Thank you, Neelam and Neeraja.
Thank you.
Ma'am, anybody interested in any other questions?
You can tell us the questions if Neelam is still there.
Neeraja, it was really a wonderful talk by you and Neelam both. Kudos to you. Yeah. Enjoyed.
Yeah. So, Gaurika, can you just check out the questions, please?
Yes, ma'am. That's what I'm doing.
Excellent talk, Dr. Neeraja and Dr. Neelam. Very practical. Really enjoyed.
Ma'am, there is a question from Dr. Rekha. She's asking that what time of the day is more suitable for vitamin D?
10 a.m. to 3 p.m. See, because before 10 a.m., the sun rays will be oblique. And after 3 p.m., the zenith actually happens at 12 to 2. So the sun is directly overhead. So whenever the sun is directly overhead, which they have said between 10 to 3, and best is your lunch hour. So that is the time.
Yes, ma'am. So I think it was a very, very enlightening talk. And I would like to thank our esteemed speakers, Dr. Neerja and Dr. Neelam, for such an enlightening talk and covering it so much lucidly in depth and in detail. And I would also like to thank all the participants for their active participation. And this would motivate us and encourage us to organize in future as well. And last but not the least, I would like to invite Mr. Maruti, who has been very much instrumental in organizing this webinar, to give a message to all the viewers.
Yeah, on behalf of Torrent Pharma, I would like to thank you all for giving us opportunity to be a part of such a highly academic event. We are really pleased to be a part of this. To be a part of the kind of programs, and with your kind permission, don't mind, then we have 1 minute before we end this airport.
Okay, so thank you, Mr. Maruti, and thank you, ma'am. Thank you, all the chairpersons. Thank you, Dr. Meeta. Thank you, Dr. Kanchan, all members of DEC, and of course, the speakers for this wonderful evening and for this wonderful academic session.
I think Mr. Maruti is sharing something.
Yeah. I'm sharing.
Yeah, please.
Yeah, I'm sharing.
Yeah, please. Because we are also all the time interested to know which product has what. We are very alert. And even the
The deficiency of this may negatively affect fetal growth, brain development, and pregnancy outcome, and breast milk vitamin content. The cyanocobalamin, or vitamin B12, goes through decyanization first. Post that, it goes through cobalamin 2 reduction and SAME methyl transfer. Then, the methylcobalamin becomes metabolically active. The triangle of B complex is essential for pregnant women in their dietary process, as while conceiving, women find it difficult to produce adequate levels of vitamins. With external supplements, they get their required dosage, which is ready for absorption and utility by outcomes, future risk to health of child, and maternal and fetal health during pregnancy. European Society for Pediatric Endocrinology confirms vitamin D3 per day ensures adequate vitamin D status in pregnancy and early infancy. Vitamin D3 supplementation helps achieve the sufficiency and can be taken for a long duration. Calcium also plays an important role in pregnancy as its twofold requirement increases. Adequate maternal health is needed for fetal bone health, and as per the BMC Public Health article, calcium supplementation during pregnancy reduces gestational hypertension by 45% and demands supplementation of prenatal vitamins. This supplementation provides protection against various defects that can occur during pregnancy. ShellCal XT provides protection against neural tube defects. It reduces the risk of preterm birth and congenital heart diseases. ShellCal XT contains 1250 mg of calcium carbonate, which is required to maintain maternal skeleton, 1000 IU and occupancy. Shell Cal XT has 1,500 at 20 mg, reduces nausea and vomiting in pregnant implementation. Shell Cal XT has special coating technology and vitamin the pill burden. Dosage of Shell Cal XT is one tablet once a day. Code tablet gives dosage After all, every pregnancy is precious.
Thank you, ma'am.
Thank you very
much. You are on mute.
Yeah, I've unmuted myself. So I think we can close the session now. Yeah, Gaurika?
Yes, ma'am.
Yes. Siddharth. Thank you.
Rashmi.
Very nice session.
Hi, Rashmi. From Bombay.
Yes.
I joined last. Okay. All the best. Bye.
Yes, Kramer. हाँ, नहीं, leave मत करो जरा रुको ये खत्म होने दो इनको अच्छा एक